Professor Michael Burawoy is professor of sociology at the University of California, Berkeley, and one of the most renowned sociologists of his generation. Throughout his academic career, he has engaged with Marxism, seeking to reconstruct it in the light of his research and more broadly, in the light of historical challenges of the late 20th and early 21st centuries. He has been a participant observer of industrial workplaces in four countries, Zambia, United States, Hungary, and Russia, and developed the extended case method that allows broad conclusions to be drawn from ethnographic research. He has been the president of the American Sociological Association, as well as the International Sociological Association, and is currently the editor of Global Dialogue, the newsletter and magazine of the International Sociological Association. So once again, I'm extremely honored to have him here. It's been we've already interacted with him on several opportunities so far while he's been here. We started by forgetting to pick him up at the airport, but he did manage to make it all the way to Lums. Since then, we've been making him earn his ticket here because he's given talks, he's looked at our curriculum, he's spoken to students, and will be doing so for the rest of his time here, which means that I don't know if he'll come back again, so this is really the opportunity that we have to engage with him on this occasion as well. In conversation with other colleagues of ours, he's been described as the greatest living sociologist of our time, and I just wanted to put that out there to make him feel a little bit more embarrassed than he might be. But I won't say any more. I just want to welcome him again and hand over the mic to him.
Thank you. I got one.
You got one.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. Thanks, man. Thanks very much, Professor Khan. Yes, no one has ever called me that. What did you say? The greatest living sociologist. Probably not many left, actually. It's a dying breed.
And after we're done with you.
Yes. Well, it's really a great pleasure to be here. It's the first time I've been in Pakistan. As I was saying, as our new president said, this is a fantastic country, fantastic place, fantastic people. And I've already sent him a telegram saying that he's exactly right. Yes. No, it's really been really a great pleasure to be here. I was actually in a class this afternoon and I was quite stunned at how wonderful the students were, how alert they were, how much they knew already, and so it must be a real pleasure to teach here. I teach in a much, no, there were about 15, 20 students in that room. I teach at University of California, Berkeley. I was just last semester teaching a class of 280 students. So it's rather a different experience. Yeah. So, well, I'm going to be talking today about a topic that has been of long interest to myself. Universities in crisis. And I'm not going to be so foolhardy to say anything about Pakistan, except, again, as I say, a very fantastic place. I'm going to actually talk largely about my own university as a bellwether for the future of public universities. But let me tell you a little bit about myself first, as how I got interested in universities. Actually, I began being interested in universities long ago, about 1967. And at 1967, I was traveling around India. I was an undergraduate at University of Cambridge in England as a mathematician, and I hated mathematics. I was not very good at it, and I didn't know quite why I was doing it. I knew I wanted to be a sociologist, but Cambridge being the antediluvian a backward place that it is and was, did not even know what sociology was. You certainly couldn't study it there. But anyway, I decided to study it by myself, and my first project in 1967, I think it was the end of my second year, I decided, for one reason or another, not quite clear to me still, the interesting problem in the world was the medium of instruction in Indian universities. So what I did, I went around India studying which was the best language, Hindi, English, or regional language. 1967, you may or may not know, was a pretty volatile year around the question of the medium instruction of English. I thought this was a technical problem. You know, basically you have to figure out whether it's English, regional language, or Hindi, and which is the most effective educationally, and then that's what sociologists should do, solve problems. So I went around the country, as I said. I did some sort of strange experiment with comprehension tests, and it dawned on me after about a month or two, traveling around on third-class railways, and so on, sort of thing I would do then, I don't think I would do now. It dawned on me that it's actually not a technical problem, that this is actually a political problem. Or it's not a political problem, it's a social problem, it's a class problem, you know? What language will the civil service be in actually determine the careers of so many people? And whether it's going to be Hindi or English, that was a big deal down in Madras. As it was then. That was my first introduction to sociology, the discovery that actually the world is made up of a whole set of multiple interests. There are no clear technical solutions, but there are all sorts of political and social struggles. So that was my first education, and that's really where I became a sociologist. When I left Cambridge, I couldn't stand England, so I left, I went to Africa, and I went to a place called Zambia. And at that time, it's 1968 when I graduated. I don't know if you remember 1968, I don't suppose anybody does here. But anyway, believe me, 1968 was a very special year. It was the year of the student revolt all over the world, including, by the way, Pakistan. I think Ayub Khan had a bit of a problem with students. Nodding heads. Okay, great. The point was that I was interested in students, I was interested in university. Actually, I thought in those days that students would save the world. I couldn't immediately study. I was actually talking about another project I did in Zambia this afternoon around the copper industry. But basically, I was there to study students, and I went to the university and actually studied the students' revolts and closures of universities, struggles between the state and students. So that was my second sort of engagement with the question of university education. And after that, I became interested in workplaces around the world. I became a factory worker in many places, and don't think that I have any privileged access to such workplaces. I am a middle-class guy. I am incompetent as a worker. But as many of you will know, if you're an ethnographer, when you come into a situation very different from the people you're studying, it creates a very interesting situation. And it's very interesting to see how in different countries people respond to an incompetent worker. But that is a story for another day. What I want to talk about actually is my coming home. I've gone local. I've been traveling around the world a great deal over the last 10 years. And I'm now actually gone home, returned home, in the sense that I am now studying my own university at a particularly great and important moment in its history, whether it will be able to survive as a public university. And I think what is happening at Berkeley is happening all over the world in one way or another. And I will see if you can, I can see any of your smiles appear on your faces as I talk about the sorts of things that are happening in Berkeley and how I see them. So that's what I want to do today, and that's why this is actually about 2011, protests around increasing fees, and I deliberately put this picture on to indicate to you I really am going to talk about University of California, Berkeley, though, as I say, many of the things that happened there have happened elsewhere in the United States and elsewhere in the world. Right. I should say also that I approach this subject very much shaped by two of my own interests, the interest in work. I'm interested in work and the organization of class around work. in the university. I've studied in factories. Now I'm studying my own factory, so to speak. And so that idea, that interest in work will remains with me. The other interest was the interest in the Soviet Union. I spent about a decade, through the 1980s to 1989, working in factories in Hungary, state socialist Hungary. I'm one of the very few people from the West, particularly intellectuals, who managed to inveigle their way actually into factories in state socialism and work there. My dream was always to be a furnace man in a socialist steel mill. I think I was probably the only person who ever dreamt of that. I dreamt of that because actually the steel worker is the prototype socialist worker who sort of transforms nature and builds socialism. Anyway, that's not how the workers on the shop floor thought about it, but nevertheless, that's how I did initially. So I worked in Hungary. I was very interested in planning, the planned economy. And when I started studying my University of California, Berkeley, I realized that I've come across yet another planned economy with the same sort of irrationalities. I suspect some of you, over here at any rate, have been educated in England, maybe. I don't know, Syracuse is not England, nor is McGill. But nevertheless, it's very interesting. Those of you who have actually studied in England will know that since Thatcher, there have been all sorts of attempts to rationalize, regulate, and control universities through various exercises known as research assessment exercise, RAE, and now with the REF, it's the Research Excellence Framework. And these are ways in which the faculty actually organize criteria of evaluating one another in order to meet some sort of targets and to establish themselves with some sort of criteria as one of five categories that will determine how much money they receive from the government. When I saw the irrationalities that this led to and the ways in which people would play the system, it reminded me of the planning system in the Soviet Union. It's ironic that Thatcher, in a sense, was the one who instigated this system. She, the sort of the free marketeer, should actually, in the process of instigating it, produce a sort of planned economy. Basically, you know, I don't know if you know about the stories from the Soviet Union. You know, basically, you know, if you have to build tractors, as an enterprise manager, you are rewarded according to not only the number of tractors, but the weight of the tractors. So the idea then is to actually build tractors that are very heavy and therefore dysfunctional. So something similar happens, I think, in the way that university education has been regulated in many countries, including particularly in Britain. So that background I carry with me when I study universities. So what I want to do today is tell you how I see the University of California, Berkeley, at this point. Now, there are four contextual factors that I think are really important. First, that we are undergoing what I call third wave marketization. I resist the concept neoliberalism as not being very historically specific. It's not the first time we've had a wave of marketization. There have been, as I will say tomorrow when we talk about Polanyi, three waves of marketization since the end of the 18th century under capitalism. So we're in a third wave of marketization, and that third wave of marketization involves a series of commodifications, the turning of goods into exchangeable objects in the marketplace. Polanyi talked about labor, money, and land, and I want to add to that knowledge, and that's what essentially I'm going to talk about today is the commodification of knowledge, the way that knowledge is now being bought and sold. So that's the second point I want to make. But if there is to be commodification, there has to be dispossession. If I want to sell my lung or my kidney, I've got to take it from my body. Commodities become sellable only when they are extricated, expropriated from their context. And so we have to also think about the way that knowledge has been expropriated from the control of those who produce it. So that's the third point. And the fourth point is that this is happening now at a sort of global level. We are very conscious of the globalization of knowledge and the ways in which universities, academic institutions are connected globally, the way they connect globally, they evaluate each other globally, and establish global hierarchies. I think one is only too aware of that, particularly if one's outside the United States. All right, so that is the broad context. Now I want to give you, you know, sociologists have all these, I don't know, perhaps they don't hear in Lums, but basically wherever I come from, I mean, in the United States, sociologists think in very schematic terms, and they are very well known for their two-by-two tables, which began with a fellow called Talcott Parsons. We probably went before him, but anyway, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you, those are my, so this is my picture that I want to give to you about how to think about the university. I've got four segments here, and I'm going to talk about four functions of the university. First, a policy function. The university actually does produce knowledge that is useful and applied beyond the university. Second, there is something called what I call professional knowledge. That is to say, knowledge that is actually pursued for its own sake within the university, part of, you know, research programs, paradigms, that sort of inform the way that we collectively progress and develop our knowledge schemes. Then we have a what I call a critical function of the university, in which the university potentially, at any rate, engages in a critique of what it goes on within its walls. The critical function of scholars is to actually critically examine what actually is being done, and to actually think about the presuppositions of what is being done, and to actually problematize those presuppositions. So there is a critical function to the university. And finally, there is, yes, a public function to the university, whether it is private or public. The university has a public function. It actually is, in a sense, accessible to publics, but it is also, in principle, accountable to publics. These are my four functions, and I believe there are crises linked to each of those functions. So there is a budgetary crisis. I don't know if here at Lums you feel a budgetary crisis. Usually they're fabricated by people. But not only fabricated. I'm actually almost convinced that we really do face a budgetary crisis at Berkeley. We are told we are $160 million a year in structural debt, which is a lot of money. But anyway, budgetary crisis seems to befall many universities, particularly public ones, that are suddenly find that they are no longer publicly funded, and so they have to find money elsewhere. Or where do they find money elsewhere? Well, one way is obviously to charge student fees, and that is happening in many places in the world, not all places. There are parts of Europe where students still do not pay any substantial fees, or certainly not substantial tuition. I always have fun in my classes, and there's always, and we have a sort of, one of the ways that we make money in my sociology department is we bring in Norwegian students. They love to come to Berkeley. Well, they did, and when their currency was not too weak. But anyway, they still come. They come for a semester. They love to come to Berkeley, and they sit in our classes, four or five, and we love it because we will say to them, how much do you pay for health care? How much do you pay for education? Do you pay fees for the university? Of course, every time it's zero, zero. And you can just see the audible from all the students around, disbelief. So there is another world possible, that's very clear. It's sitting next to you. But anyway, so, but the point is that actually in most countries in the world, student fees have actually been increased. That's one way in which universities make money. Our money comes also from, in our case, from federal grants. It comes also from donors. And money can come in all sorts of, through all sorts of entrepreneurial ventures, like the one I just told you about bringing in Norwegian students. And there are real consequences for this, this search for money, because the people who search for money, they're special people. They're called financiers. And what happens is the university begins to employ financiers, people who think they know how to get money, whether it's from donors, whether it's through patents, whether it's through formulating fancy research grants. And this creates a second crisis, a governance crisis, because who comes in are administrators who are tasked with getting money. They are what I call spiralists. They spiral in from outside with some long CV of all the achievements they've had. They're not necessarily, and sometimes, and very often, not academics, know little about the university, but know a lot about finance and corporations. They come in, they have a signature project, and then they spiral out, and we spiral down. It's a tragic situation, but it has all sorts of consequences, because they recruit one another. They come in, and then they don't recruit, for the most part, faculty to join them in the administration. They recruit other spiralists. And so you get a bloating of the administration. An administration that is often unresponsive to the faculty and student interests. And has all sorts of really problems as far as any form of shared governance is concerned. There's a governance crisis. And then we find there is an identity crisis. An identity crisis in the sense, you know, what are we doing? We, faculty particularly, but students too, well, what do we do? Is this a business or is this a educational institution? And then students themselves say, are we here just to get a credential or are we here to learn? There is a deep identity crisis about what the university is about anymore. And finally, there is a legitimation crisis. The university has increasing difficulty to actually establish its credibility vis-a-vis publics. The university was always presumed to be part and parcel of modern society. I remember when I was in Zambia, the first thing the Zambian government did, post-colonial Zambian government did, was first to build a university. To be sure, there were only 100 graduates in the country at the time, but nevertheless, it was a sort of symbol of nation building. It was you couldn't have a nation without a good university. And so, but those days are long since gone. The university today has to struggle for its legitimacy, for its credibility with the wider public. And it becomes more and more difficult as fees increase and as the delivery of those fees means that students get a credential, which is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for a job. So there's a systematic precaritization of actually the people who get university credentials. So the university is not delivering in that way. The university, because it had been accustomed to having credibility and legitimacy, doesn't worry about being accountable to publics and constitutes itself as an ivory tower. It does not make efforts. It may make efforts to be accessible to broader publics, but it does not make huge efforts to be accountable to those publics. So there is a real problem of its legitimacy. Cannot take the university for granted anymore. So that's the overall situation that I see. And I'm going to end by trying to give you some suggestions about how one might cope with this, but they're not going to be totally convincing. And of course, I'll be very interested in your responses. So let me get into a bit more detail. So what I think one has to do in order to begin to figure out how the university operates in this sort of distorted functional way. In fact, in sociology, we would call this a manifestation of goal displacement. So essentially, the drive for money has actually displaced the goal of the university, slowly but surely, away from the educational project itself. So students are recruited increasingly on the basis of the fanciness of the services that are rendered to them. And universities are successful insofar as they can get a sponsor, a good athletics team, so that they can acquire money from donors. So this sort of moves the university away from its central purpose, the education, the production and dissemination of knowledge. And I want to look at this from the standpoint of class, and as you see, I have four classes here. We have an administrative class of spiralists. Not all of them spiralists, I'll say in a minute. Faculty, service class, and students. Service class is a very heterogeneous class. So, and I divide them into two. We have these very senior managers who are indeed, many of them are spiralists, but we have academic administrators who will sort of come up from below the sorts of deans who are themselves academics, who find themselves often in a very difficult position between the faculty and senior managers. We have faculty, we have ladder faculty, namely faculty that are on a tenure track, and then we also have faculty who are non-tenured, who are called variously contingent, adjunct faculty, or sometimes they're called lecturers. And these faculty may have relatively good conditions, they may have full employment, they may be under very precarious conditions, hired from one semester to the next. So it's a very, very variable, they're very variable conditions of employment for such teachers. At Berkeley, they're relatively well paid, and many of them are quite secure. We pay them between $10,000 and $12,000 a course. At CUNY, City University of New York, they're being paid $3,000 a course, and $3,000 a course is really very, very little in the United States, particularly in New York. So basically, they are paying to teach almost. So anyway, the conditions vary greatly. And what I will argue is that actually these lectures are going to become ever more important to the university, as the university makes every effort to freeze the number of ladder faculty, tenured faculty, and to increase the number of lecturers. That is the general prognosis. We see that in all the figures. It varies the extent to the rapidity with which it occurs from university to university. So, all right, that's the faculty. The service class, well, there are those who are stably employed, and then there are outsourced workers. One of the ways of saving money is, of course, to do a lot of outsourcing. Actually, there have been struggles at Berkeley to try and prevent any outsourcing, and most of the outsourced workers have been now insourced. And students, undergraduate and graduate, and their situations are very different. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But anyway, what I want to do is to do a sort of class analysis to understand the way in which these functions, the four functions I talked about, are entering into a crisis. So, all right, let's do this quickly. Now, let me say this. There is this dominant class of senior managers, senior executives, if you will, on the campus, and they are spiralists, and they have a whole ideology to justify their existence. And they have a vision of the university. The vision goes like this, in the case of Berkeley. Oh, we are wonderful and excellent. We are basically the best public university in the world. We are in the top three or four in the Shanghai Jiao Tong. They don't mention this in the QS rankings, they're 26. But nevertheless, okay, we're doing... So this is the top public university in the US. Okay, we're excellent. But not only are we excellent, we have great access. Yes. We have more low-income students than all the Ivies put together as measured by these Pell Grants. 23% of our students have Pell Grants. These are basically supplementary income from the federal government. 82% graduation rate, that's pretty good. The average overhaul in the whole country, it's an astonishing figure, but only 50% of those who start university actually finish university. So 82% is pretty good, particularly in 4.5 years. And 53% have no debt. That's amazing. And the average is 30% less than other publics. So our average debt, for those who have debt, is $17,000 when they leave the university. The average for the country is about $25,000, $26,000. And, well, faculty and students are more diverse than ever. Well, it depends what's the time period you're dealing with. Yes, there's diversity in some directions and not diversity in others. African Americans we do terribly in. But Latinos we do quite well. Lots of Asians, of course, yes. Anyway, so okay, this is the story. And then finally, just think of what our degree contributes. So they calculate, not unreasonably, I suppose, that a degree is worth $1.3 million over a lifetime. Mm-hmm. And, yep, and the state gets 450% return on every dollar it invests in the university. They're clearly trying to sort of put the blame elsewhere. Mm-hmm. That's the Berkeley narrative, and there is truth to this narrative, like all good narratives. But it's not the only truth. Then they say this model is under threat. State contribution to the budget has fallen from 34% to 13%. If they started in the 1980s, it would be falling from 50% to 13%. So that's a huge drop in the state contribution to the campus budget. And as I said earlier, the university suffers at this point from a $160 million structural deficit, which it blames on the fact that it's an old campus and has had to reconstruct many of the buildings. Yes, yes, well, Yeah, there are other reasons. But now, so that's the story, and let's give it a few figures. So here's the UC, this is the University of California as a whole, which consists of 10 campuses, Berkeley is just one of them. But anyway, overall, the University of California, here we see it's the UC share of the state budget falls from 8% to 2 point something. Okay, so that's a very clear statement of the declining proportion of our budget that actually comes from the state. And there was fees. Fees start here about just over $4,000 and end up here about $13,000-$14,000. Because one of the ways of actually getting money is to get foreign students. Oh yeah, it's interesting. Foreign students, they pay $34,000-$35,000, not $13,000. Mm-hmm. Yes, so if you come from Pakistan, you'll be doing us a great favor. Yes, and so there was a huge fight, because what's happening has been growing up gradually, particularly after, let's see if I got the figures. No, that's all right, I'll tell the story now. That after 2008, the university was in such financial strait that it thought the only way it could actually get more money was to actually bring in more students from out of state who would pay this two and a half times as much as the in-state students. And so the figure goes up to now nearly 30%, 27, 28% of our students are out of state as opposed to 10% before. And then a whole political row develops in the legislature in Sacramento. Well, why? Because, of course, the legislature, the assembly people, the senators there, they have this constituency, right? And their constituents saying, look, you know, my child cannot get into Berkeley. He's got straight A's. He's just the best top of his class. We still can't get in. And then they hear 30% of the students are out of state. Well, then, of course, they're furious. And so there is a big movement in California, which is channeled through the legislature against the university, but particularly a place like Berkeley, because not all the campuses have quite as high a percentage. Well, it's channeled against Berkeley because, of course, it's recruiting. And Berkeley said, oh, no, it's not our fault. We have no money. We need money. So It's not a very productive, never productive political debate. But that is what is happening. So then we lose legitimacy once again by recruiting. You know, this is the University of California, so be first and foremost for California students. Anyway, what we see is this increase in fees, and of course, for foreign students or out-of-state students, it's three times or two and a half times as great. And if you look at the figure as a whole, when you look at the revenues, so basically you see this numbers of students has increased from since 1990 from 150,000 to 250,000. What you see is in blue is the state funding, and it sort of goes up. And then that goes down and then up and then down and up. But basically, it's not really systematically increased, though it has increased a little bit since 1990. But what you definitely see is the yellow, which is the student tuition that has systematically increased over time and since about 2011, 2012, the amount of money coming in from fees has exceeded that coming from the state. Right. So then you can see that the administrative class says, you know, this is not our fault. It's the only thing we can do is increase fees. Of course, now they've frozen fees. The legislature has actually frozen fees. And so they have to find other ways of trying to make the loss in revenue. Okay, right. And here, this is a story of expenditures. I'm not going to go into detail. What is important about this picture is what it doesn't show. That essentially, it's a story about, all right, what's it? It's measuring student financial aid as a expenditure. We have auxiliary enterprises, unnamed. Other inflation-adjusted, unnamed. Support activities, inflation-adjusted. Instruction, public. I mean, you haven't a clue what they're talking about. I mean, this is what happens in universities, that the budgets are meaningless. And this just hides what's really going on. And this is one way of thinking about what's going on. So this is a figure, they've actually scrubbed this from their website now. I've been propagating this figure. So you can't get the figures anymore. Well, it's not so easily anyhow. But this is a story of what happened at Berkeley in terms of the change in personnel over the last 20 years. And what you see, I think you can see it. What is remarkable is first and foremost the number of senior administrators has increased fivefold. Academic administrators have slightly increased. These are the academics that are promoted into administrative positions, people such as deans. And by the way, don't ask me who these are. Nobody will tell me. I can't find out. I mean, if I were an ethnographer, perhaps I could go from office to office and figure it out. But nobody will tell me. I've asked five times in Senate meetings. Nobody will tell me who's making up these people. Well, we can see, you can see if you just look at the organization charts, the sorts of people they are. Faculty, you see, it's more or less frozen. Lecturers are increasing. And graduate students, more or less static. And enrollments, somewhat increasing. In fact, we just had to have a big enrollment increase because our legitimacy is so low because we have brought in so many out-of-state students. Yes, so what is this administrative class? Well, when you ask them, well, what's happened fivefold, they say, well, federal regulations require we have regulatory personnel. They say that we have we have to have more and more administrators of research as it expands, and just the very development of the campus requires an expansion of personnel, administrative class. And what you see also, so I won't bore you with all the details here, but they actually engage in all sorts of fancy projects. This is a spiralist, they come in and have their signature project and then they spiral out. Let me just pick on the rebuilding of the stadium. This is a real great one. So You know, you want money, you want it from the donors. Donors require football teams. Football teams have to win. So you, first of all, you employ a coach. It's about now $2 million a year. That's how much coaches cost. The Chancellor gets $550,000, which is big enough as it is, but $2 million for a coach, they're expensive things. And the trouble is, if they don't deliver, you fire them, so you've still got to pay them, and then you pay another one. I don't know exactly how many, it's two or three that are on the payroll at the moment. But, you know, if you want to attract those donors for $150,000 to $250,000, lifetime seats, to watch. Yes, to watch a football team, but a losing football team, who wants to pay $150,000? So, didn't work. No, people did not want to pay $150,000 for a seat to watch a losing football team. So, that left us in a huge debt. This was the legacy of the Chancellor before last. So, and I could, that's the most extreme case, I must confess. But there are similar projects that have turned out to be disasters. So, the point I'm trying to make is this administrative class is actually sometimes operating with a sort of very sort of confined set of understandings and interests about how the university works, but they don't care because they can move on. The Vice Chancellor for Administration and Finance left us after 5 years, a year ago. He came from the World Bank, and I don't know what part of the financial world he went back to, having spent 5 years overseeing these sorts of projects. Okay, so I just want to emphasize that when the university, the senior administrators, present the world, they don't present this. They don't actually talk about all the problems are outside or they're with those faculty who sort of creating trouble. But basically they distract, turn the attention away from themselves. Yeah. So, all right, so faculty, that's the administrative class. What about faculty? Well, it's been a really transformational, the last 40, 50 years, if we look across the country, 40 years ago, the proportion of tenure track faculty was 70%, 30% lecturers, now it's reversed. So now, basically, we have, this is just a broad figure, for the country as a whole, 30% of the instructing faculty are tenured or on tenure track, and 70% are lecturers. So, of course, this has all sorts of implications for the future of graduate students. So, if you look at Berkeley, well, you see again the faculty is frozen. The number of lecturers is still less than faculty, but it's so we're behind the curve, but we are slowly but surely catching up. And if you actually look at the number of, well, the likelihood of a student being taught by an instructor that is faculty as opposed to lecturers, you can see that the number of lecturers, the number of credit hours taught by lecturers is actually increasing. And actually, the faculty there is frozen in numbers, and actually our conditions are getting better. We are actually teaching less than we were 20, 30 years ago. We may be doing more administrative work, but we're teaching less. So we're becoming ever more a protected labor aristocracy. And that is to keep us probably compliant, or perhaps that's not the intention, but that's the consequence. And at the same time, the army of lecturers increases. As I say, the conditions of lecturers vary a great deal between universities and even within the university. Yes, all right, service workers. Well, what we notice, there's an increase in financial services and student services and in low-paid service workers. If you look at these figures, you can see the clerical workers, not surprisingly, have declined. Fiscal management has slightly increased. Student services very significantly have increased. That has gone along with student fee increases. Yes, so I don't have a lot to say about these categories. They are, as I say, very heterogeneous. They are there increasingly for sort of controlling the campus and channeling many of the grievances that students have about the way that they are being taught and the conditions on campus. Students themselves, well, as I said before, they are actually financing their own education, but they are also the support for many of the other sort of non-educational functions of the university. That we have a fee increase, but also what is important in many places is the cost of living is increasing rapidly, so it's increasingly difficult for them. And now we have surveys of actually food security and of actually students who are actually having to miss regularly, have to miss meals. So there's an increased consciousness of actually the impoverishment of students. Many of them are actually come from very poor backgrounds, and so we offer them relatively little aid. We have financial aid, but that really concerns tuition and fees. Actually, we're quite progressive in that regard. If your family income is less than $80,000, then you do not pay any fees. So indebtedness is relatively low compared with other campuses, and we do have all these Pell Grants, but they don't actually amount to much. $6,000 is not that huge. It's certainly not going to help people survive on the street. All right, so that's it. And then there's education. As I said before, graduation rates are pretty good, and there is a limited choice of major because, as you can imagine, these days students want to become economists or engineers or computer scientists, and so there's a limit of access to those majors, and the spillover comes to sociology, amongst others. In fact, we have an enormous major. We have about, I believe you have about 2025, I don't know if it's an official secret, but no, okay, 25 majors in sociology, we have 600. So it was, and it has been increasing over many years now. So, yeah, I like to think there are other reasons than the ease of access. There has been increasing diversity, increasing numbers of transfer students from community colleges. 50% of our majors actually come from community colleges, yes, two-year colleges. So you can see this is the figure of out-of-state students. Suddenly after 2008, it shoots up when the university is really strapped for funds because it's being ever more restricted by the state. Yes. So, okay. Now, students, graduates. This is a really interesting and problematic category because there are fewer tenured positions for graduate students. It varies, of course, from discipline to discipline. If you're in English, there haven't been positions for a long time. Sociology, well, there are still positions, but they're basically overall there are fewer positions, and therefore there are fewer graduate students. Basically, departments decide that they can't bring in so many graduate students, and so what happens as a result of that? Well, these graduate students are crucial. They may be there to actually promote their own careers. They may be there to actually move on and become full-fledged faculty. But if their numbers are shrinking, their other function, namely teaching undergraduates, declines. And so we're ever short of what we call graduate student assistants, teaching assistants, who will actually make our lives as faculty easy because they do the grading and they do the face-to-face teaching. So this is a real problem. The fewer graduate students, because there are fewer jobs, means that lecturers are actually becoming ever, ever more important, and they will soon be taking over the actual job of graduate students. So yeah, so that's a very serious issue. And the result is the stretching of resources is a poorer undergraduate education, less and less well served. So more and more, so graduate students have to teach actually more and more undergraduates. They are teaching assistants for ever more numbers, yes. And so what I'm suggesting here is what's happening over time, it's a big grand conclusion, is namely that the university was always conceived of as somehow combining research and teaching. This was the distinctiveness of the US-American model, originally came from Germany. But this is breaking down, that increasingly there is a bifurcation. Faculty are actually now teaching less, focused perhaps more on research, And teaching is taken up ever more by people who do not do research, namely lecturers, whose conditions of employment are very variable. And so there is increasingly a disunification of disconnection of teaching and research. Yes. Now, is there a solution in the political field? Well, of course, I'm assuming that the political field is all fixed and constant. I mean, the question is, can the university recoup funds from the state, from the California state, from the federal state? Well, I really should be revising this after the last 2 weeks, but I'm still going to stick with it, because California is a weird place. California has a democratic legislature, supermajority in both houses. I mean, this is weird. I'm living in a bubble. So let me just tell you what the political field looks like. We have our 10 campuses of the University of California. And here we have UCOP, the University of California Office of the President, who oversees the 10 campuses. Napolitano is her name, former Secretary of Homeland Security under the Clinton administration. Why she is president of our university? Good question. But she is. Boy, is she tough. Okay. So basically she oversees the 10 campuses. She's appointed by the regents. The regents, about 24 of them altogether, are themselves appointed by the governor, a fellow called Governor Brown, who's not been governor. It's not the first time he's been governor. It's like one of your prime ministers. So he actually appoints the regents, and at least half these regents are actually executives, businessmen. And it's they that appointed Napolitano as president of the university. And then there's the legislature. And there's obviously a bargaining relationship between the governor and the legislature. And the legislature tries to influence, and does indeed successfully influence, the regions, because it ultimately controls the purse strings. That is the picture. And the question is whether the University of California, the campuses, can actually somehow build or rebuild its legitimacy in the public sphere by making concessions, by actually recognizing that its administrative class has to go, or has to be confined, or has to be controlled, because those people in the legislature know only too well about the executive salaries of that administrative class on campus. So it's a matter of, can one control that administrative apparatus? Can we actually, another concession we should make is to actually recognize that we shouldn't be recruiting so many out-of-state students. That's a politically no-no. So it's a matter of whether there can be some negotiation between campuses and the legislature to rebuild, to somehow rebuild the public character of the university, to somehow actually move the university, not just in receiving more and more people, but actually engaging more and more people. Can we reconceive the public university, which is my last point, what is to be done? Yes. Well, first of all, as I might suggest, the critique of these spiralists, they shouldn't be left off the hook. There should be, as a basis of that critique and much more, a critical community within the university, something which is very hard to sustain because of the divisions amongst different disciplines, amongst different schools, divisions that are exacerbated by the actual budgetary situation. Yeah, so can one build a critical community that will actually begin to actually reconstitute university? That's the big question, whether we can build some bonds of solidarity. Do the engineers, the sociologists, the economists have something in common? Or basically the engineers and the economists are sitting pretty and don't care about the sociologists? And it's not really sociologists, it's the historians. How many majors you got in history here? I didn't say. Hassan, I'll never tell anybody. So, you know, it's the historians, it's English, literature, language programs. So are they going to survive? So it has to be, if they are, there has to be some sort of critical community that sees that there is an interest in saving the university as a whole. So we rebuild the public character of the university, which means, as I say, having both access and going out, being accountable to publics, has to conceive of itself in a very different political way and has to build an alliance, in this case, with the legislature. Though, of course, California is very unique. If you go to Arizona, you go to Wisconsin, there's no way you can build, the university can build any alliance with the legislature. Hopeless. That's what's to be done. It really is a very difficult, grim situation in which the majority view is we have to privatize. And that means making all sorts of concessions in terms of the way the university is run, and we will then become a second rate at best, and a degraded university. That is my view. So that is what I have to tell you, and I'd be very interested if it has anything to do with what's going on here. Thank you very much.